We're back! Welcome back, ZeroK fans. This is the last weird play for tonight. 400 and Corvus Korags versus Edible and Magman on Avalanche, which I should note is more of a 1v1 map, so I imagine this will not be a particularly long game. But it might be interesting because we do finally, for the first time tonight, have a match where all four players are about the same Elo rating, which is around 1850 or so, except 400's at nearly 2000. But the rest of the players are roughly even. So that should hopefully provide a more exciting match than the last two. I apologize, those last two were, they were interesting demonstrations of how it can work with one high elo and one low elo player on the team, but I realized they were not the most back and forth exciting seat of your pants matches that would really define more of a tournament style match. But hopefully this should be much more representative of the matches we shall see on the tournament, which once again is this Saturday, October 25th, 2014 at 9 a.m. UTC. Look in the ZeroK website or the forums. There should be a universal time code converter. You can then convert that to your local time zone and thus figure out when you should come. Please don't be late if you are participating. Know what time you need to be there. Get there on time. And good luck for all people who are playing. And for those who aren't playing, you might as well. There's nothing to lose except maybe like a few hours of your day. So let's get to the game without further ado. Edible Magman over the northeast side of the map, Jump Bot and Heavy Tank Factory respectively, while on the southeast side of the map we have 400 going for Cloaky, while Corvus is going for a light vehicle factory. Corvus going for Slasher early on, Slasher Scorcher, so kind of want to be defensive. Early on Darts and then Slasher from there, while on the other hand, early Pyro, a couple early Pyros, a couple early Warriors from 400. Nothing yet from Magman, they're going straight for the Morph, investing all their resources into a Commander Morph right off the bat, while 400, on the other hand, is going for early Warrior. And Magman has, well, they've now just started to build up stuff in the Heavy Tank Factory, or so it would appear. Yes, there you have Welders coming up. So both players playing rather defensively, or both teams rather, having one player playing defensively and the other one playing a bit more of a later game assault. Pyro being about the only aggressive, early game aggressive move made so far, actually. That's about it, this one here. So I'm a little bit surprised to see that. I've got to be honest, I have not really seen that sort of play. Admittedly, you don't see a lot of, well, actually, you do see a lot of team games on small maps. Icy Run in particular, that's notorious for this. But in the 2v2 tournaments, typically the smallest maps, I don't even know, I think Badlands was played once. That is the same size. It is 8x8. Or, I think it's 8x8. I think it's about the same size. However, there are a lot more ridges. It's a lot harder to, there's a much smaller, sorry, smaller rush distance here. Longer rush distance on Badlands, and the Pyro trying to get in here, but blocked off by the Defender Nest. Corvus Korags going very defensive. Surprisingly mixing Slasher and Defender. If they're going to leapfrog Defenders, the Slasher doesn't make as much sense. But they're continuing with that into Levelers now that they know that Jump Bots are there. And actually, let's double check what they do know. I'm pretty sure they don't know anything. They actually have no knowledge of the main bases of Team Blue, which is not something that can be said for Blue Team, although for the most part, yeah, actually, Blue Team doesn't really know what Red Team is up to either. They have some knowledge though, but not a whole lot. They don't know the factories necessarily, but they will fairly soon. And as we can see, 400 going over to the southwest side of the map, attacking from there with a Zeus and a Warrior. Should be a very strong attack, actually, going through there, hitting the commander right off. That could kill. I think that's going to be a kill, in fact. The Zeus should stun out the commander pretty quickly while the Warrior just deals the rest of the damage. Yeah, I mean, between the two of them, that commander's going to get stunned out. It's going to die. There is no follow-up forces coming up to the north. Edible is about to lose their commander right off the bat. Four metal, six energy, losing half of their economy due to the loss of their commander. Their reaction is totally justified in the situation because that was a massive blow. Well done, 400. Perfect choice of units. Like I said, I was a little surprised to see that, but that was a perfect choice of units. That was exactly what was needed. Expertly done. So 400 continuing on, losing the Warrior, unfortunately. That wasn't quite so expert. They did not pay attention as much to what was going on there, but definitely will be able to break open that side. And the Panther should be able to finish off the Zeus. It's going to be a bit of an even, actually, you know what? Maybe not. It's going to be a matter of, the Panther can't be hit. That's the issue. The Panther gets hit one more time. Oh, there we go. The Zeus gets the kill, or should be able to get the kill. Panther not going to stand out long enough. There we go. That's not long enough, but it doesn't matter. The Panther about to go down. Stunning out the Warrior, though. Sorry, stunning out the Zeus for a couple seconds, but that doesn't even give Magman's commander enough time to get in. Magman's commander with Rykan and auto repair. Does it have enough range? Not quite. Very close, though. We'll be able to catch up to the Zeus, but not before the Zeus deals a bit more damage, maybe gets rid of a couple wind generators. And at the same time, front side of the base, Corvus Korax coming in with all the slashers. I suppose they were very useful in the end. But this Zeus, despite doing the damage it did, not actually going to be able to do much more. But still, it'll actually get rid of a wind generator or two. Doesn't matter, though. The front side attack is the big deal. And an attempt to expand over to the northeast by Edible gets blocked off by another defender nest by Corvus Korax. And a bunch of glaives from 400 waiting in the wings just to go for a massive raid attack. Possibly going over to the southwest. We do see some warriors approaching from the southwest once again. Looks like a follow-up. Another backdoor attack, which should be fairly successful. Although 400's commander is in the way. That will be a problem. But even then, I mean, this attack from the front is doing decently well. The Jack is doing a nice job trying to push it back. But even with that, that Jack has gone down massively in itself. It took out a lot of slashers, though, which is very good. But even then, this level, we'll be able to take it out. And that's, what, 500 metal? 600 metal. And it took out about 300. Yeah, that's not worth it. That took out maybe 450 metal worth of units. That Jack really did not do the trick. His leveler, however, is overextending itself quite a lot. Actually, very much overextending itself. Corvus Korax, Magman thanks you for the donation. Magman or Edible, one of the two, they thank you for your donation of a leveler's worth of metal. Because that leveler was overextended. It should have been pulled back at that point. I couldn't really see any. There was the mech. That was the only high-value target I could see that the leveler had a chance of killing. Probably was going for the Jack. Probably was trying to finish that off. And at this point, the Jack now going for a second round and actually should be able to deal quite a bit of damage this time around. 400 wisely jumping their commander out of the way, avoiding the avoiding that Jack. Not even upgraded, but don't want to lose that. I mean, this is a very tight game. This is a knife fight. Edible's commander loss has been a massive advantage for Corvus Korax and 400, but that's not an advantage that they'll keep if they lose their commanders themselves. At this point, though, it's not as big of a deal. They lose about a quarter of their economy rather than half, and Edible hasn't even recovered. Magman's expanded the most, but Edible has not recovered. As you can see, 400's taking the southwest side of the map. Corvus has taken the northeast side of the map. This Jack is basically the only thing that Edible had. Nope, still has. Still has. That Jack's still alive, just barely, thanks to the Freaker and the Welder. That's the only thing keeping that Jack alive. Very wise use of repairs there, because that's all Edible has. That's seriously Edible's entire army right there. Wait. Nope, still it. Still in. That Jack is still very much alive. But at the same time, 400 and Corvus Korax have the economic advantage. They just need more power. More energy. Get a few more power plants up, and that should do the trick. They'll be able to push out all they need. Domination's coming in from Corvus Korax as well, which I'm not sure I totally... Actually, wait, no, I totally agree with that. That'll take the Jack. You can't repair away from Dominatrix. That Jack is as good as Corvus's at this point. Although Magman's commander might be able to put a stop to that. We'll see, though. It looks like the Panther's going to be the first target. Take one of those, but that's a really risky strat. No, it's not even a strategy. That does take out a Panther, but that... Will that even work? Looks like no. Looks like the Dominatrix will actually go down. Yep, the Dominatrix goes down. And that was a bit of damage to that Panther, but not enough. Not what the Dominatrix wanted to do. It wanted to take the Jack, and that's not going to happen. That Jack, able to deal quite a bit of damage, started to break that front line, in fact. Though it looks like loss of a Panther takes it up. The loss of the Commander, that is the big blow. But even then, even with that, Edible losing their Jack, that was their entire army lost to kill a Commander. Trying to get some Pyros now, but with only 5 metal and 9 energy, they will not be able to do that in any decent amount of time. And 400 Corvus Korax are excessing metal. They need energy. So at this point, they have actually quite a lot of build rate they can work through. They still have an economic advantage. Even with the loss of the commander, 400 retains the economic advantage that they had acquired earlier on. They have the southwest. It's all theirs. It just belongs to them. Not much more needs to be said. The southwest belongs to them. And another Panther actually being taken by a Dominatrix. Will go down before the Dominatrix itself does, but that doesn't mean much. The Dominatrix moving away. Looks like it's targeting the commander. I don't think a Dominatrix can capture a commander. I'm not totally sure, but I don't believe that is the case. I don't believe they're actually capable of doing so. However, the commander has retreated, getting out of the way of the Zeuses, which are a massive threat. And actually, with all that, they did break the lines. Edible and Magman broke 400 and Corvus Korax's lines well enough to take the center. They're taking the half side of the map. Or at least their corner. The southwest and northeast still very much belongs to 400 and Corvus Korax respectively. But at least the center is a bit more in Magman's hands. However, that is still not saying a whole lot. That really isn't. Magman and Edible, their only chance at this point is basically to try to pierce through the center. Get through the Dominatrices, and that is not saying anything lightly. and then destroy the factories directly. Or actually, you know what? Going to the sides would probably be a better idea. This is a naked expansion over here. These lotuses and this warrior is about it, but even then the panthers aren't on enough to break through. So the southwest is still very much in 400's hands. But yeah, it's a naked expansion, so if they were able to get in, they could take out a lot of the metal extractors, very much slow 400's economy down. Corvus Corax, however, still has a very strong position over to the northeast with that Stardust. And neither player on Team Blue is really getting much to deal with this. They have another Jack. Yet another Jack has been built, and it is going over to the southwest. However, surprisingly not going over. See, what I would expect is it would go here and then jump over this cliff. That would be the thing to do. I don't think 400 has revealed where their stuff is, though. I don't think that Edible knows. Oh, no, maybe they do. Oh, come on, show me. There we go. Yeah, they know there's stuff here, but I don't think they know exactly how little there is built up. However, the Jack, able to just pierce through without having to worry about anything, breaks the Lotus down just to make sure that any further units can get through. And now that's a naked expansion, which at this point, there's some pressure now on Corvus Corax to 400 to deal with everything. Basically try to win the game in the next couple minutes, because that southwest is about to go down. That Jack will take out the entire southwest area. There are no more defensive turrets left, and nothing that would deal with a Jack especially. So not a whole lot of time there, but it looks like 400 and Corvus Corax have the army to deal with this. Getting rid of the Stinger. There's only a Stinger and Defender's Nest to deal with. After that, there's not much. The Jack is out of position to deal with defense. It's fully committed to offense, and these Zeuses are fully committed to offense as well, but in the better position. Honestly, I think this is game. I think 400 and Corvus Corax have just taken it, but they are not pushing forward. Surprisingly not pushing forward. And the Jack is moving back. They have, at the very least, forced this back. They lost one metal extractor and given some reclaim, but that's about it. Mostly gave Edible their commander back. Surprisingly did not reclaim the commander in the entire intervening period. However, the Zeuses are coming in. They are taking everything out. And 400 should be able to just sweep through the entire northwest side. Deal with all that. Moho Geothermal built in the northeast for good measure. Corvus Corax having a massive overdrive investment. Right now, what's the overdrive here? Yeah, 200 some odd percent overdrive. 3 times overdrive on these metal extractors here. And if they're connected down to the south, they got some pylons over here. That would be insane. Doesn't matter though, because this is basically it. 400 is marching through. Edible and Magma having the economic disadvantage for most of the game did kill them. They fought well. They did a really good job trying to pull back in. Very valiant effort, but not quite enough. The Jacks definitely proved that they are a very scary opponent. Definitely kept things in check. Definitely kept 400 Corvus Corax from winning too quickly. But at this point, the economic advantage is so huge. And now there's a dozen and a half glaives that can just come in right after the Zeuses. I mean, they should actually probably come in right now, in fact. Taking out Magman's commander, down it goes! The glaives, if they came in here, would deal a lot of damage. In fact, they could just run straight past the Jacks entirely. And they are not doing so. They're going straight for the Jacks, but that should work as well. Because the Jacks just won't be able to deal with them. Just too much firepower at once. And the Jacks don't really have much splash damage, so that is game. That does it. I think that we are seeing a vote resign, and Team Blue has voted to resign. And that settles it. That is game. And that is also going to be it for tonight's stream. So thank you once again for watching, and like I said, remember there is the tournament on Saturday. Saturday is October 25th at 9 a.m. UTC. Check the website. That will get you the information and get you the time zone converter so you can know what time it is to be there. Be there on time if you are going to be playing. If you're not going to be playing, well, if you want to watch the stream, then be there on time too. But yeah, so I'm going to have that streamed on this channel on Hitbox. I am still testing out Hitbox for October. I have heard a few complaints, so I'm not sure how likely it is I'm going to keep Hitbox through November and beyond. But yeah, for October, I have committed to testing it for October just for myself. I mean, it's not like I've talked to the Hitbox people and said, I'm going to test your service throughout October, and that's what I'm doing, and sign some contract. No, I just want to test it, give it its fair shake. So far, it's proven to be a little bit disappointing, but we'll see in the tournament. That'll be the real test when there's actually, you know, a dozen, two dozen people viewing. I know, that sounds really low, but 0K. It's not the biggest community, unfortunately. But yeah, when there's actually quite a few viewers, as there normally is in Twitch, see how that goes. See what problems crop up then. See if there's issues with quality control. Like, having the quality controls available. And also, just so you know, yes, Hitbox does have a near zero chat delay. It's like 2 to 5 seconds. I will put on a chat delay. I will... Not a chat delay, sorry. A stream delay. There will be about a minute's worth of stream delay. Hitbox actually allows me to do that from Hitbox itself. I don't have to do it with an OBS, which is very convenient. But yeah, there'll be about a minute long or so stream delay. Just bear that in mind. So, yeah, the chat is going to be delayed, not because of Twitch or Hitbox or any... Oh, she is because of Hitbox. I'm making it because of Hitbox. But it's not because of Hitbox, not because they can't. It's because it's a tournament. It's a 2v2 tournament. Like, it's a tournament. I don't know if there's having any issues with stream sniping, but it's not something that is worth encouraging or allowing. So there's just going to be no stream sniping. Just not going to allow it. So yeah, that is going... Well, obviously can't really stop it. But a minute delay is probably going to be enough for 0K. Anyway, that is going to be it for me tonight, like I said. So thank you once again for watching, and have a good night, everyone.